This week's episode is sponsored by White's Beaconsfield. White's Beaconsfield is the number one company in the UK to brighten up your smile at a very affordable price. Get your perfect smile today using code AGJamesEnglish at checkout for a 15% discount on all products.
White's Beaconsfield. I'm on day 5 out of 7 and my teeth are looking white.
So it doesn't contain peroxide, so it's very, very safe for you to use on your teeth. It doesn't cause any sensitivity and I've literally got the most sensitive teeth.
The most affordable product, works like a dream.
Look how white, with no filter, no sensitivity, and it is just one of the best that I've ever used.
Like, that's 3 days, it's crazy.
You can now follow me on all my social media platforms to find out who my latest guest will be. And don't forget to click the subscribe button and the notifications button so you're notified for when my next podcast goes live.
All my education was how to rob, how to sell drugs, how to violence. And, you know, obviously care home for me was quite difficult with violence. I was always small and older boys will be boys. So when I sort of got a bit older in my teens and, you know, when I knocked someone out, I thought, fuck, like, I can knock someone out. Like, you know, I got quite addicted to that. I always said to myself, I'll never be a victim inside. I mean, I'll never lay down for anyone. I would always stand tall. And that was always very strong to me inside. So I thought, you know, if I get weighed in, I get weighed in, but I'm always going to stand tall inside. You know what I mean? I had a difficult time with bullying when I was younger. But when I started getting to age, I realised, listen, I can fight, I can have it. I wasn't going to let anyone take the piss. And obviously, I got into a fucking lot of trouble inside.
Is that how you got your 10?
No, that's not how I got the 10. I got out after that. I got out and obviously I was recalled. And then when I was inside, that's when there was a lot of problems. There was a lot of issues. Obviously, man, I had to go to prison. I went to go to Broadmoor. You know, like, my label is that, like, I'm the only guy kicked out of Broadmoor since Bronson. And obviously the sentence I received was indefinite. It was, it's called the Section 3741. There's no release date. There's no day you'll get out. And I remember a doctor said to me once, he said, you'll never get an out. He said to me, you'll never get out. He said, you're lucky to get out before you're 40.
How long did you do in Broadmoor?
I did 2 years in Broadmoor. 2 years.
What was that like?
What was it like being in Broadmoor?
Yeah.
When you've got every extremist trying to kill you, when you've got people just want to beef, when you've got hot water and stabbed in weeks of being there, when you've got, you're 21, 22, I was, you know what I mean, you got no one. It's done, it's game over, it's another world, it's hell.
Ben, we're on. Today's guest, we've got Ben Hatchett. How are you, brother?
Yeah, I'm good myself.
Good to see you, bro.
You too, man, you too, thanks for having me.
Yeah, man, great story. In prison for 10 years.
10 years,
fighting, yeah. Bit of a roller coaster. Biggest fight was in there, but now you're out. You've made a career into professional fighting. You've got your first fight coming up.
We have, at the minute, obviously, COVID's causing a few problems at the minute. Obviously, I was meant to be fighting under Alan Mortlock for the IBA. But at the minute, obviously, COVID is this hand.
Of course, mate, but you just got to keep your head above water.
Yeah.
Obstacles come. This is just another test for you, how you react. And it is what it is, but you're out, you're free. How long have you been out now?
It'll be 3 months this Friday, 17th of July.
So start early.
Ten years, man. It wasn't just prison, like, Obviously, it was mental hospitals, obviously.
Yeah.
Obviously, the most notorious was obviously Broadmoor, Ashworth, Obviously, I did the high school prisons, but now I'm out. And yeah, obviously
flying, bro. Sitting here, mate. You must be flying, brother.
Like you said, when we spoke on the phone, law of attraction. Law of attraction must be working for you, brother. I was like,
I always go back to the start with my guest, bro.
Yeah.
Where you grew up and how it all began.
I all grew up. Obviously, I grew up in the south coast town of Eastbourne. I was born in Hastings, and I grew up in. Obviously, I had to travel around a lot in foster cares when I was younger, from Hastings to London. So yeah, I went back with my family, but you know, certain things happened. It didn't really work out. Obviously, I got involved with the antisocial street life. Sort of found my comfortability there. I felt comfortable in that. I liked being around. I liked the dramas. I liked all the. You know, I was addicted to that. I liked all the antisocial and bullshit lifestyle. And, you know, I'm one of them people. I'm very all in or nothing. I'm like all or nothing. So when I was in it, I was in it. There was no like, I had no guidance about trying to do good things. It was all, my education was all antisocial. So
It's difficult, especially with abandonment issues. A lot of the people I interview who pretend to be bad men, you'll tend to see a lot as being bullied or abused when they're younger. There's always a link that the gangs and stuff, the violence becomes. It's like a comfort. If you do bad things, you're accepted from like a gang, but it's the wrong kind of gang, if you know what I mean. It's like you're doing things for approval of others, but it's difficult for such a young age because you don't understand that. No. You know what I mean? Were you kind of running wild then from a very young age, feeling neglected?
Yeah, kind of like, you know, like I said, I didn't have any like really positive role models in my life. You know, there was one woman I did, which was my brother's mum. Unfortunately, she passed, and that was tough to deal with. You know, so I never really had anyone sort of solid in my life to sort of give me advice, give me good advice, then give me like trying to put me on a positive road. You know, like I think with everyone, you know, I think the world, a lot of people, they want to, everyone's quick to like sort of put people down. It's like the world again, I feel it's all like very sort of suppressed. You know, there's not a lot of people trying to build people up. Do you know what I mean? It's sort of like everyone's, you know, what's the word? Antisocial, everyone could be quiet and negative, and do you know what I mean? People like, getting their like, sort of comfy zone. There's no one there to sort of build people up. And I think, you know, a lot of things today, which I'm trying to do today is, like things we're doing today is trying to send that positive message, trying to plant seeds in younger generation's head, like letting them believe, look, you can go and achieve things, put that energy into what it is that you want to do. I never had that as a kid. All my education was how to rob, how to sell drugs, how to violence. And, you know, obviously care home for me was quite difficult with violence. I was always small and older boys will be boys. So when I sort of got a bit older in my teens and, you know, when I knocked someone out, I thought, fuck, like, I can knock someone out. Like, you know, I got quite addicted to that sort of, we can fight, do you know what I mean? And people start saying about your name and you start popping, you're like, yeah, man, I'm getting known. It's not like I'm that small boy now. I'm someone like, I could fuck up your shit.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And it sort of
gives you a bit of self-worth that you can harm somebody, but also gives you protection.
Yeah.
Drilling fear into people will give you a sense of power where we're so fragile and vulnerable that we don't want to hurt any more of ourselves, that if we start knocking people out, if we start stabbing people or shooting people, we'll drill fear into them that will leave me alone.
Yeah.
And it becomes an addiction as well. It's crazy. What about your schooling? Did you ever go to school?
Nah, not really, bro. I went there for a bit, do you know what I mean? I lived in one area, went to school in another, and it was just sort of, nah, didn't really fit in. I always felt like a bit of an outcast. I always felt like a bit of an outsider. Do you know what I mean? Like, I never fitted in. Like, school definitely wasn't for me, you know? I don't know. I think the school system's very, very outdated. And I think, you know, it's not for everyone. Do you know, some people, you know, people can do it. They can do the grades. But I was never interested in it. It just wasn't there. Like, you know, certain elements of it, certain traits, like certain classes. Sometimes I just learn little bits and that. I'd find that quite interesting. I'd be on it. See, I'm like, with the schools, if there was like certain, it's very structured, but if there was like sort of things for people's inclination, like different sort of subjects, different things people do where they could like focus on that, maybe, you know, it would have been different.
Yeah.
Did you get what I'm saying? Yeah, like, that makes sense.
All kids were all different. Everybody's in schools, it's your creativity and individuality. Just because you can't crunch numbers or read certain things, or you might not want to stand up in the class and read a book out, or you might not be the best painter, but I don't fuck all at school. I'm dyslexic, but my vision is unstoppable. My self-confidence, self-worth right now is unstoppable, and yet I was told I'd never amount to nothing. Sure as fuck, I'm fucking making them people eat their words now. Do you know what I mean? But again, I feel blessed that it's took me 30 odd years to realise that I'm good enough. And it's difficult as a kid. If you get put in a very small box, then people judge. Man Les Brown, I've said this quote many a times, his teacher said, he always says, people's opinion of you doesn't have to be a reality. Teachers back in the day were telling you, you'll never amount to nothing, you'll do no good, you can't learn in this class, you don't know your times tables. I don't mean shit. Some of the smartest men in this world have created the best things in this world are people who never stuck in at school.
Yeah. You know the story of Einstein?
Yeah.
It was one of, like, again, on my change journey, when I learned about it, it was like, it was actually quite antisocial at school. When I first heard this, I think I read it in a book by Robert Greene, that, which one was it? Mastery. So I was reading that book, and there's that story about Einstein, and it was saying, like, he was quite antisocial at school. I was like, what? Einstein? He's like, you know, Mr. Genius, isn't he? When I think genius, I think Einstein.
Yeah.
And it was like how he was antisocial at school, and it was actually, I think, I kicked out or expelled, and like some Swedish professor took him to the special school and gave like let him focus on his vocation, let him put all his, like, what is his inclination, which happened to be obviously quantum physics, and that, you know, and he obviously changed the game
from the world,
because he was able to sort of not focus on all geography, this and maths and all this sort of other stuff. He was able to focus all his energy into what he wanted.
And what he believed and what he loved. And that's what it's all about, is to find your passion. Yeah. We're lost. Human beings are lost. We don't know anymore. We're so dumbed down, sitting at a desk, 95 from the ages of a kid, 93 at school, and then it's 95 when you become an adult, then it's the alcohol kicks in, then it's the TV. TV's called a programme for a reason. It programs your brain to tell you that the world's a bad place. Trust me, the world's a fucking good place. And if you don't think so, then go out and be good yourself. It's as simple as that. And you've just got to kind of change the way you think, change the way you look at things. We all attract what we think, which we'll touch on later on. But yeah, Einstein does say everybody's a genius. Everybody is creative, but just don't believe in myself enough. Nobody's confident enough. Everybody wants approval. Everybody wants to ask people for, can I do this, can I do that? But fuck everybody else. People ain't going to tell me anymore. I'm fucking sick and tired of it. Now I just create. Now I just do it. I know it's going to be the best. People can look and say it's cocky, arrogant. I don't care. I'm confident. It's took me 36 years to get to where I am now, but this is only the beginning to where I'm fucking taking things. So I understand what you're saying, and especially schooling. Yeah, it's a weird thing, but people, the majority of people go to university don't even use a degree. Do you know what I mean? Some people think they go to university and they think they're better than everybody else, but they fucking ain't. It's how you treat others. That shows your currency, how you become a better person and change from your mistakes. So when you were going through all your schooling in and out, were you in homes and stuff as well, teenage years?
Well, the first time. Yeah, I did some first times when I was younger, obviously growing up, so I had to do that.
Were you drinking or anything, smoking weed?
When I started getting to my teens, when I was like, because the foster services like abandoned me. If I had like mega money and I sort of like opened some investigation and was like, you know, foster services dropped me at 15 because I was turning 16, I'm sure there'd be some sort of like, hold on, they weren't really meant to do that, but they did drop me, and that's when my brother's mum took me in, my foster brother's mum took me in. But I had charges hanging over me from violence, or police, and I don't know, I was just catching all these different sort of charges out on the street. Mm-hmm. Most of them was all like violence orientated. So,
when did you first go to prison?
16, young offenders for ABH. Yeah, it was ABH.
What did you do? What sentence?
8 months to four.
So how was that for the first time in the YOs?
Where'd I go? Was that for Huntercombe? I went to Huntercombe. You don't know what to expect. Remember,
scary, mate.
You see all the sort of programs and all that. You just don't know what to expect. Yeah. You got to remember, I'm from East Sussex. I'm from the South Coast, bro. Do you know what I mean? In them sort of jails and that, it's more sort of like cities, like London, all them sort of places. So like, there's a lot more guys who know each other and all that. So again, I'm going up there. It's like a school thing again. I'm going up there. I don't know anyone. There's not many people from my area like in these jails and that. I'm just seeing all these new faces and that, and then obviously you get people that wanted to test you. But the thing is, I always said to myself, I'll never be a victim inside. I mean, I'll never lay down for anyone. I would always stand tall, and that was always very strong to me inside. So I thought, you know, if I get weighed in, I get weighed in, but I'm always going to stand tall inside. Do you know what I mean? I had a difficult time with bullying when I was younger, but when I started getting to age, I realised, listen, I can fight, I can have it. I wasn't going to let anyone take the piss, and obviously I got into a fucking lot of trouble inside because of that attitude. But
Yeah.
You know.
Why did you think you had to fight so much? Because you didn't want to be bullied anymore?
I don't know, James. I think I might just have one of them looks about me, to be honest. But I think it is. The amount of times I got started on inside, bro, it's unreal. Like, over the street, I don't know if it was my size, my look, my throat. I don't know what it was, but I just... Fucking something, innit? I must have one of the phases, bro. Like, literally.
But again, if you say... If you were short and stuff as well, you tend to see people do put on a swagger.
As if
to say, look, I'm fine. But then that becomes a target for the bigger boys. It's fucked up, man, the way humans think, especially in prison as well.
Yeah.
That's crazy, man, the method of thinking. But that is what it is, and sometimes you can't change it unless you actually see other people changing. Mm. But you have made so many changes, man, to where you are today. But when you were going through the YOs, when you get out, what was your life like then? Did you have a place to stay? Did your friend's mum still take you in?
No, unfortunately, she passed.
Sorry to hear that.
So that was, you know, very... You know, obviously, it was
difficult time.
Yeah, it was. It's still raw. I feel for my foster brothers and all that. It's a hard one, but yeah. But then I chose the street life many years after, and I got involved with a knife crime myself. So it was a protection sort of thing. But you know, at the end of the day, I did what I did, and I take full responsibility. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, if people wanted to attack me, you know, I defend them as well. I didn't defend myself. There's a time when you could stop. I didn't stop, and I have to live with that. And, you know. So.
Is that how you got your 10?
No, that's not how I got the 10. I got out after that. I got out, and obviously I was recalled. And then when I was inside, that's when there was a lot of problems. There was a lot of issues. Obviously, man, I had to go to prison. I went to go to Broadmoor. You know, like my label is. Like, I'm the only guy kicked out of Broadmoor since Bronson. That's my label. And obviously, you know, with the Amazon Prime film that's coming out, obviously all the information, what happened, that's all going to be, you know, it's all going to be revealed why. But my story's very sad, James. You know what I mean? People might just think, oh, like, is he one of them sort of thugs? Is he one of that? It's not. There was a massive battle for me inside. You know, I got put in, was it wrong or right why I got recalled? You know, I didn't do nothing, but... Once you're on licence and you get recalled, when you get arrested on licence, you're just recalled without sort of court or anything like that. Do you know what I mean? Yeah.
What did you get recalled for?
ABH.
Second time?
I think I've got about 8 of them on my record, to be honest, bro. Like,
have you?
Yeah, like, I caught, yeah, my previous. At that sort of time, my teens was quite bad.
So how did you get your 10?
When I was inside... Again, it was all problematic behaviour. Like, again, from... Because I can't say too much, because obviously the Amazon Prime film, obviously, But the charges from escape attempt to... There was a GBH, alleged hostage taking, what they called it, false imprisonment. So obviously the sentence I received was indefinite. It was... It's called a section 3741. There's no release date. There's no day you'll get out. And I remember a doctor said to me once, he said, you're never getting out. He said to me, you'll never get out. He said, you're lucky to get out before you're 40. So
that's scary. Did that not scare the shit out of you? Or did it make you more rebellious? Well,
I was 22 at the time, I was like, when am I going home? He said, you ain't going home. Like, I mean, you'll be lucky to get out of your 40. I was like, think of what the fuck, like, all them things that I'll never have, never be able to do. Do you get what I mean? It goes through your head, and obviously, you know, we all know the saying, it's fight or flight. So for me, it was just fight. So all that emotion and anger I was carrying, I just fought the system. And obviously, you know, I had a lot of, what's the word? There was a lot of tension between me and the extremists inside. Obviously, the inside, you know, back in prison, I was attacked for no reason, for having a British bulldog on my left. And it says Tottenham, so it represents, like, you know, I used to love boxing, I support Tottenham, it was like a combination. But they took it as something else, and yeah, I got attacked quite severe in prison. I saw one of the guys when I was in Broadmoor, and I got my own back on one of the guys that I think orchestrated it, but I didn't realise he was high up in the old fucking guy either. Do you know what I mean? It was, you know, the hook guy, you know, remember the hook?
Yeah, yeah.
It was all his little firm. Mm-hmm. It was all his firm that was inside at the time for all these mad fucking charges. I don't even know. But I just see it as like, I don't really care if you was this or that, or you're part of this or whatever. The way I saw it, like, you lot attacked me for no reason, bro. Like, it's like, so I'm going to get my own back. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It was like, I don't care what you're representing, what you're part of. You orchestrated four people to come in my cell, kick my teeth out, break my ribs, and fuck my eye socket up. So it's like, and I remember because he used to like lead all the prayers and all that. So I thought, you know what? I'm going to get you back. And I bounced a cricket ball off his head when I was in Broadmoor. Not a cricket, but yeah, cricket ball. You know how heavy they are?
Yeah, that's heavy.
Imagine that. Mm-hmm. Fall on the thing. Like, and obviously they just took it. They wasn't happy.
Did you ever see psychologists in that at the start of your sentence?
No. They just tried and talk, but I didn't entertain nothing like that. I was young, I was broken, and I was struggling, and causing dramas was my release.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
what about, when you got to Broadmoor, how did that come about then? To go to is it psychiatric?
I remember when I did engage with the psychologist, and oh, you're like this one. This is you know when they say like when the penny drops.
Mm-hmm.
You know when people say like, you know, we meet people that have changed and they all say when the penny drops. I remember when my penny dropped, and you're like this. I think you see this. So do you remember the Mayweather and Pacquiao fight?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was gonna, everyone wanted these two people to fight for years, didn't they? Manny Pacquiao and Mayweather. Mm-hmm. Who would win? Do you know what I mean? And obviously, you had like two sort of, you had two people fighting for two different sort of, they represent two different things. You know, Mayweather obviously is, you know, massive respect. You know, he's amazing at what he does. But, you know, he's very like, ego is very like sort
flamboyant,
of flash.
Yeah,
flamboyant. You got Manny Pacquiao, you know, he's very involved. You know, when Civil War stops when he fights, he's involved with his government. You know, he comes hard from poverty. Like, mm-hmm. Although Mayweather doesn't come from money, but he, you know, he's earned it, he's proud of it, whatever. But you got two people, and Pacquiao was like, you know, we got the world on the attention on us right now. We can make a difference. And I just don't think Mayweather really entertained it. And, mm-hmm. and it was like the psychologist said to me, you know, you've got two different people fighting for two different ways. Like, what is it you're fighting for? And I remember sitting in my cell that night thinking, what the fuck? Like, you know, what am I fighting for? What am I doing with myself? What am I doing with my life? Like, and then I saw the Zen monk. Now, this always talked to Zen monk, and he was saying about how letting things go with emotions, and he got me meditating. I thought, what? Just sitting there all quiet and shit. I was like, come on, bro, I'm not really into all this, innit? And he's like, no, just try it, let it go. And all these thoughts, I've got quite an active mind. I'm like, da 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 da. And I started doing that, letting it go, and I just felt there was like a bit more. And then I come across this book, The Key to Living Law of Attraction, and I read that. It was like everything just started making a lot more sense. And in my life, it was like when I started realizing the whole law of attraction, I just, you know, I wrote, I was in segregation. The last time I assaulted someone was 7 years ago now. And I was in segregation and I read this book and that, and I just thought, wow. And I started writing all these things that I want to achieve. I want to write these goals. I want to write these. And I sat there with the universe. I got in that whole meditation spot and I sat and I did, you know, I know I was being in Broadmoor and that. And I tell people I spoke with the universe. The universe didn't speak back, but to me, it was very spiritual. I sat there with the universe and I made a deal. And I said, listen, I will never hurt another human being, obviously with outside sports, with the boxing, like in a, you know, in a malicious sort of way, if you help me achieve these goals I've got. You know what I mean? And sat there. And ever since then, I still had a battle. You know, they told me I was never getting out. You know, they told me I had to go through like a tribunal, what they call parole, every year. But I'm ticking these goals off. And some of them were little and some of them were big. Do you know what I mean? And I'm mm-hmm. just ticking them off. And the universe, like, people start coming into your life. It's fucking crazy. When you look all this stuff on YouTube, your law of attraction is so true. If you put that belief, that conviction into it, and you really have set what you're trying to achieve,
mm-hmm.
the universe will attract that into your life.
Yeah. The law of attraction, people think you just think it. You must believe it. You must believe you already have it and then work your ass off to get it.
Yeah.
The people watching this have got to understand everything that's created in this universe has started off with a thought, whether it's this microphone, whether it's that chain, whether it's the cameras, whether it's an aeroplane. Somebody's thought, I'm going to do that. It started created by one thought. Yeah. And if you tell people that, people will speak you out of it because they don't know your journey. They don't know the goal. So you've got to protect what you have. And if you believe in it so much, anything can be got, anything can be achieved.
One thing you said there, you got to believe you have it. There's a difference. Sometimes I say to people, like, I say, what are you going to have in 5 years? And they start telling you what they want. Oh, I want this one, I want. And that's where they're going wrong. There's two words, there's want and there's have. The minute you believe, you realize, no, I already have these things, I have this. There's a big difference between putting your energy into having it and wanting it.
Yeah, definitely. You must just believe you already have it, and that everything is frequencies and energies, and I keep saying it, and the more people will watch, the more people will understand that you are what you think. It's as simple as that. You are what you put out there. The life you're living now, you've created it.
Yeah.
Whether it's a life of chaos or whether it's a beautiful life, it's what they want. It's what they created. You sitting here, you've created that. It happens.
Yeah.
Just visualise. And it's you must believe it, though. We've got so many distractions. We get into a car and it's music. We go home, there's fights and arguments. We get into work, it's noise. When you sit and meditate and listen to your thoughts, it's scary because it's 100 miles an hour.
Yeah.
When you actually try and quiet it down, that's what people don't realise, because people's lives are full of chaos. They don't actually realise how overthinking they are. I always say disease causes disease, and if you're thinking about the past, you will bring yourself pain, misery, fear, distractions. Same as concentrating on the future too much. It's trying to bring yourself into the present moment, which is difficult because, again, it's the outside noise. We just don't know what to do. We don't know how to think right. Everything's just created through, you are what you eat as well, you are what you speak. You speak, if you speak good, you will attract good. And if people gossip and shit, listen to how your phone calls are. If your pals are phoning you want to get mad with for the weekend, if their relationships are breaking down, if you hate your job, they ain't people. They ain't that's anything people you want to aspire to, because it's black magic as well. If they're speaking like shit, they're going to feel like shit. And if you're taking that in your conscious mind, you're only going to start attracting that as well. So it's try to distance yourself. It's scary. Change ain't fucking easy. It's so scary, man. And it is a lonely journey as well to start making changes to better your life, but it can be done.
100%.
Your prime example.
I'm
going to
start law of attraction right now. Do you get what I'm saying?
When did you really start believing it? When was that moment you say, okay, this is working? For all your life of misery and pain and realising that you're in there, you might never get out. When did you realise, what was that moment? This is working. I'm going to change.
When I started with the universe and I said, I've got this channel. When I visualised it, I felt it. Do you know what I mean? I see one girl fire until I fall there. I know I can go and be there and I'm making a difference. I see it in my head.
Did people think you were crazy?
Yes.
But all they thought you were crazy anyway.
They message me on Insta. They message me on social media now. I get staff. I can't name them. I get staff messaging me, FaceTime me, say, oh, what you're doing is amazing. I don't think they're fucking allowed to do that. I used to tell these people, like, I'm a fan, tell you I'm going to do this. And there's lads that are still away, yeah? And, like, they're part of me. Like, they feel it. And they're all written. I know I still keep the people that show me love when I was away, I don't forget them. I don't forget the things that when I was down, people would say something to build me up away. You know, some of these guys are never coming home. And I haven't forgot. I still send them DVDs and I still answer that phone to them. Because what I'm doing that is for them and that as well. It's giving them sort of
hope.
Yeah, giving them hope. And they're feeling it. And they're buzzing for me. They're not hating them. I'm doing it. They're like, it's like they're here with me. Do you know what I mean? And it's like, yeah, it's when I told them all I was going to do this. And I always talk about it all the time. James, I said, no, I'm going to do this. I'm going to find a telly. I'm going to make a difference. I know I've got a story. I'm going to try and send as many positive ripple effects out there I can. And, you know, how do I know it's working?
How long did you do in Broadmoor?
I did 2 years in Broadmoor. In 2 years.
Exactly. What was that like?
What was it like being in Broadmoor?
Yeah.
When you've got every extremist trying to kill you.
Mm-hmm.
When you've got people just want to beef, when you've got hot water and stabbing and weeks of being there, when you've got, you're 21, 22, I was, you know what I mean, you've got no one, it's done, it's game over, it's another world, it's hell, you know, what did Bronson say about Broadmoor in his book? You have to, like, before you put out there, check the quote, it was saying, like, if I could live in hell and rent out Broadmoor, I'd live in hell and rent out Broadmoor to my enemies.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? Roy Shaw. I still remember when I read his, but I still remember the quote. The nicest thing that I can say about Broadmoor is I survived it. And I support that quote.
But you were one of the youngest in there?
When I was in Broadmoor, I was the youngest. I didn't meet anyone there who was younger than me in Broadmoor.
Is that a lot of medication in there for people? Or is it a lot of...
Yeah, of course, medication. You don't take that medication, it's sticking a needle in your ass, bro. You kick off, it's sticking a needle in your ass. I mean, so
did it feel hazy being in there? Was it everything a daze with the medication and shit?
I'm mentally scarred from what then, and I think what we were talking about earlier, like the first tattoo I got out when I was James, like, you like this one, the first tattoo I got when I got out, yeah, I got this within days. It says PTAW.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what it means?
No.
Prove them all wrong.
Yeah, I like it, bro.
That's the first tattoo I got when I got out. Because everything I said, you know, when I was there, all that hate, I have a lot of hate from Broadmoor. Don't get to it, I got a hate. And I got a lot of negative there, but I channel that energy to drive me, and I know what I'm doing. Do you know what I mean? Even that's what I said, I'm going to prove them all wrong. When I told them I was inside, and I said, look, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, they laughed, and you know what? And now they're sitting there thinking, what the fuck? Like, what's this guy doing? This guy ain't even been out 3 months. And I met K. Coke last week.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm a fan of K. Coke. Like, I used to listen to his music when I was away, and we was talking Law of Attraction as well, mm-hmm. and he believed it and that, you know. He believes in the karma, and obviously that interview's going to be on the Amazon. But for me, meeting him, it was like meeting fucking Eminem or something. You know, I listened to Skeezer so much, his CDs were broke. I think I had to get, I didn't tell him this, so I thought I'd try and keep it grounded.
But what about a fanboy?
I'm a fan, I love you, bro. I'm a fan of his. So when you're saying there's like moments, there's many times, especially getting out, I feel like, shit, is this working? Like, am I fucking, do you know what I mean? Can I do this and that? And then there's moments like that. Under this Law of Attraction, when I met, you know, Liam Galvin, who like this, how the filming, like, do you know how like the whole Amazon thing started? So when I started about wanting to write my book, so I rang up like a ghostwriter organization, and now the thing is, the writers, these ghostwriters, they have like multiple jobs, so some of them are journalists. So when I got talking with this ghostwriter, they were good asking their questions and et cetera, and I said, I want to write a book about Law of Attraction. I was at this place, that place. And I did mention that name, Dale Cregan. So I was like, I was in there, you know, I was in there with all these sort of people. You know, we were just talking. Maybe I got caught slipping when he was asking questions about writing a book. Anyway, when I was in a medium secure hospital in Howlsham called the Helenite Centre, and you get like a pay box on the ward. So this is like a lower secure now. I've made it out of the higher secure, so I'm there. And anyone can ring this pay box, and the phone box has rang, and a patient's come up, and you know, someone's rang the phone for you. So I've gone up, and it's a guy from the Sunday Mirror. I was like, hello? He's like, is this Ben Hatchett? I was like, yeah. He goes, oh, you know, you're interested in writing a book, and you start talking about questions and all that. I'm thinking, but you're not a book, bro, you're the Sunday Mirror. He's like, yeah, we just want to do a story about your thing. I was like, nah, mate. I started shitting myself. I thought, look, I could get sent back to fucking high secures for this shit. I'm scared. So I don't want to know. 2 days later, this like, and the phone's gone again. Someone's got me for the phone. I ring, and it's like a young female voice. Oh, hi, Ben. You know, oh, my name's Amy from the Sunday Mirror. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, come on, mate. Like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. That's a bit dirty. I've been away all these years, and you're doing that. Like, yeah. Do you know what I mean? It's like, wow, what? I was like, listen, I can't do that. I should have said nothing. Leave me alone. I was like, yeah. So,
yeah. When you left Broadmoor, where did you go?
Ashworth. There's 3 high secures in the country. I did 2. When Broadmoor kicked me out, I went up to Ashworth.
What was that like?
Scousers are cool.
Shout out to the Scousers.
You know what? Their sense of humour, their banter's on point. I tell you what, a lot of them, obviously you get your arseholes and that, you know, in them sort of places and all, but do you know what? I say nice things about, you know, Ashworth. A lot of them was good there. The gym staff, the psychologists, you know, lads. Again, you get your ups and your sort of downs. But for me in Ashworth, I grew as a person. I did a lot of growing there. It wasn't easy. There's some big, you know, some things coming out on the movie. Like, you know, I was accused of allegedly going to take one of the most infamous people in the country hostage. It was alleged, but they say alleged, I was punished for it. But obviously all that will be coming out and that as well. Mm-hmm. So there's some big things coming out.
When did you start doing boxing then?
Mostly in Ashes, started training when I was younger. I trained a bit, but you know, when you're involved in that street life and that just takes full priority. But then in Ashworth, there was a former staff, and he actually, you know, he's quite known, Tony Quigley. And do you know what? I respect Tony Quigley so much, and he's a staff, and he fought Paul Smith in the Echo Arena.
Yeah.
But you know, unfortunately, he had some like things happen to him, and he went through it. And next thing, he works as a staff, and you know, in Ashworth, and I was always kind of about boxing, and I was always UFC, and I was always trying to train. And then when I was telling him what I wanted to do, because I put him in my book at the end, like people are saying thank you to. Every time I used to tell these people, these staff and guys, I used to tell them what I'm going to do when I get out. They was like, oh, all right. They would entertain it, but they just knew. They just thought I was fucking mad. They was like, whatever. Like, do you know what I mean? I could see it. Like, they thought, you're fucking mad. But, all right, mate. Yeah, yeah, sweet. Do you know what I mean? Do you want to do some colouring in? Like, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, one of them ones. But when I said it to Tony, we were sitting there playing a game. He spun the chair around. I said, how are you going to do it? And he sat there and he was like, And it's the first person I've been speaking to about, and it's the first person I could see in his eyes, was fully interested and fully believed and gave me amazing advice. And that's why I put him in the back of my book. And he, like, the advice he'd give me, I don't know if I get in trouble, but he used to show me footwork, and he was saying, do this, do that. And the gym staff, they were all supportive of it, you know, when I was, they show me little things on the side. I can't name them because they'll get fucking sacked. Yeah. But, like, they know who they are, and they know they, you know, they all contributed to what I'm doing now.
That street fight's totally different from a boxing fight. 100%. Do you know what I mean? It's totally different techniques, totally different endurance. Mm. It's different adrenaline. It's crazy, man, that people think because the skin's scrapping the street and then take it into a ring, it's a different ball game.
Mate, it's a journey I'm on. Like, I thought I could have it. Like, someone might have said, I've knocked some big dudes out. Like, I've had some scraps. But this boxing game is a game changer. Like, the footwork and everything. Like, there's some guys, you think I'm about to box, and I think, I'm gonna hurt you, and all of a sudden, bam, bam, bam. I'm like, whoa, hey, you know, I got to start getting all the footwork. And like, well, my cousin Nicky, he's very good boxer. He's done the boxing for a while, and he loves exposing me. He loves getting them digs in. Do you know what I mean?
That's good, man. You need a bit of competition as well, especially sparring. So you're ACAT then all your whole sentence?
Majority of it, yeah.
When did you start working down it?
After Ashworth. Yeah, done all the therapy, and that's
how it. Was it doing therapy for you? Speaking about your past, your trauma, your pain?
It's just like, no, it's intense, but obviously I did a lot of it like one-to-one with a psychologist, and I think once you learn about yourself, there's a saying in my book, it's like, to become who you are, you must know who you are. And I put that in the book, and I think you know what I mean by that, innit, personally.
Yeah, definitely.
If you want to be who you are, you must know inside who you are, and that's not, and you need to like look into the nitty and the gritty as well. You need to really realize who you are and what you're representing. And so I learned about emotions, letting it go. It's like a lot of these young guys that know, it's like whether they're having trouble at home or they're going through some bits, and then someone will say something, like say Nelson, I call me a dick, and he'd be like, hey, he's trying to mug me off, and all them sort of all them sort of files in his head, like all that word relates, and it opens up this big file. So it may not be, and he'll go mad, but it might not be that word where he went mad. It's what associate, it's what emotions connected with what that person said. And that's what's, you know, and I think once you learn how to let things go, focus on yourself, focus on what you're doing, and trying to, and, you know, do that positivity. Yeah. I think you know.
Because as human beings, it's easy to talk about the good points. It's easy to bum yourself up and talk how amazing you're doing, or you do this, or you make this. That shit don't mean anything.
No.
Let's talk about your pain. Let's talk about what you're addicted to. Let's talk about what skeletons you've got in your closet, because when you can do that, you will fucking truly heal, because you've got to accept to heal. 100%. Everybody's scared. That's why it's so easy to be successful in this world right now, because so many people are weak as fuck. Nobody wants to face reality. We hide. We hide behind it all, mask it all with fucking bullshit. Whether it's drink, drugs, overeating, anger, frustration, whatever it is, we mask some sort of pain by the external stuff. But let's talk about the deep stuff. Everybody's vulnerable.
Yeah.
I always fucking say it. We're all vulnerable. We're all weak. We all have flaws. Yeah. But when you actually own it and go, do you know what? Fuck it. This is me. You accept it. You get the fuck out of my way. It's as simple as that, man. And we only get one life, as far as I'm aware. But how are we going to utilise it? Your hours of the day, your seconds of the day, what is it you're doing? Are you lying in your bed feeling sorry for yourself, self-loathing? Are you going to get fucking up, put your foot in the floor and say, do you know what, I'm taking this day on, fucking head on? I don't stop, man. We're non-stop, me and Nick here, man. I don't want to stop, because I know how fucking fast you can lose it as well. Do you know what I mean? I'm on the rocket ship to fucking the stratosphere, and I need to make sure that I'm working hard on everybody else and staying humble, staying focused. But again, I'm still self-loathing and still seeking there. I just want attention as well. Is it fame I'm craving? Is it money I'm craving as well? I've got to question every scenario, same as yourself. We're overthinkers. We visualise, but we also question everything, what we're doing.
Do you know what I mean?
It's scary to think. So when you're doing the boxing in prison, doing your stuff, coming down lower, did you realise that there's a chance you were getting out? When did you start thinking, okay, I'm getting out here?
I think once I'd done all the therapies and you know, everything I was saying, I was sticking to it. I think that's when, you know, certain staff started becoming on my side. You know, inside it's all political, it's all politics. You know, if they let someone out, they let people out, they go do something drastic. The papers, you know how the papers do this shit with loaded language, isn't it? It's the domino effects, and they don't like letting people out. It's very hard to get out of them services. Well, where I went many years without violence, everything I was saying I was doing, I was trying my best, they see it, you know, I carried myself well. I got attacked 3 times and didn't retaliate. You know, again, I must have this fucking look, innit? Even when I become positive, law of attraction, I still get twatted a few times.
It's like test, so.
Yeah, but I never retaliated once. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, I come from violence. I was always quick to retaliate and I didn't retaliate once.
That's how was that feeling for you not doing that?
So proud. First time was hard. I went to myself, I thought, nah, I need to fucking back out. Like, I think I need to do something. Like, I don't know about this actually, man. Like, he probably whacked me in my mouth, like, you know, and then you're looking in the mirror like, oh, my colour's cut, like, you know, let it go. And the second time it happened, the guy was unwell and just attacked me at football, and let it go. And I remember when I was in a meeting, and the meeting was secure, and they were talking about, it's like a risk meeting, about what your risks and that are. And I remember when I saw it, and this was it, one of my goals. You have, like, high, medium, low, violence, you know, risk of violence, always high. High, always high. And when they've done this risk assessment meeting, for the first time, it said low. And I was so proud, because I put that in my book. I want to be seen as my violence, the risk is low. I put it, I don't know how I worded it, but I put it in there, and I saw it, and they had like this projector, they put it there, and like, to them, they just thought, fucking enough, it's progress. Well, to me, but to me, it was something special. You know what I mean? I thought, I'm doing right. You know, the universe is coming through with me now, man. Mm-hmm. I'm doing something right, and obviously how me and Liam met and the people that I'm meeting, you know, Joe Egan was amazing. Joe Egan is one of the nicest, humblest, giant men ever. Oh, I love the guy. We've become friends. Mm-hmm. We're going out for dinner. Honestly, man, he is amazing. The way he talks and that as well. Honestly, he's a top guy.
Yeah, I love Joe.
You know, having his support, you know, because the guy, he's got a past as well. And, you know, be able to connect with someone like that. It's amazing. I meeting Dave Courtney, I'll tell you, that's something as well. Like, when me and Dave Courtney met, and it's like, you know, he has that very sort of charismatic, you know, you know, people like him and they don't.
It's a showman.
Yeah. But with the interview me and him had, people are going to see a different side. They're going to see a bit of a different Dave. I think where I'm coming from, a lot of people relating to it. They see that, you know, people I meet know I'm a bit fucked up. They know, everyone knows what I've went through, and you know, I carry a lot of pain. I carry the demons, you know, they call it PTSD, whatever they call it. I'm carrying it because of what I went through at a young age. It's not easy. But me and these people, I think they're realizing they're connecting and everyone's supporting. Like you today, you know, you've seen you bringing me and what we're trying to do, the message we're trying to send is amazing, you know.
Yeah, that's all we can do, mate, is try.
That's all it, man.
That's all we can do is try. Did you have any visitors while you were in jail?
When I was in Broadmoor, I was done. I disconnected from everyone. I was done. I didn't want to see anyone. It was over. You know, when I was in the jails, a few of my friends come up. But towards the end, when I was local, I had fantastic support. Like, you know, the staunch ones, my cousins. You know, when I went away, my cousins were little. There was all boys. There was all little boys in there. Every time it's going to the house, he was trying to attack me. There was like a little team of them. That one be grabbing the leg, one be jumping on me. They're men now. They're boxing me up and that now. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? So I've moved away with them. And I'm building a relationship more with them, and that, you know, I have friends that if they're still doing that antisocial stuff, I'll see them, I'll always be polite, I'll never not. But anyone who's, you know, negative or not trying to do, you know, not trying to see a vision or wants to try and put it down and all that, I just, do you know what I mean? I've got this goal, I've got this dream, I've got this vision, I'm doing it, you know.
Are you still meditating now?
I do my best to, right?
It's difficult,
I'm still adjusting, James. Do you know what I mean? I'm still
early, 3 months.
But not even 3 months, shit. Yeah. You know, 10 years, you know, 10 years. I'm still adjusting, still trying new foods and going here and going there, not thinking, shit, I've got to be back now. Like, I need to be better this time. I've got to get up at this time. I have to take my medication at this time. And
you out on license or anything?
I'm on like a hospital license, but yeah, they're all supporting for me to come off it in a year. They're very behind what I'm doing. They're trying to recommend me. They're putting a reference. I'm trying to work with the No Knives, the organisation where I live, is a local community centre for the No Knives. And yeah, so that's going really well. They're supporting it because that's my main goal at the minute. I'm having meetings and that with the managers and all that at the No Knives. So actually to be able to try and, yeah, doing all this, it's amazing. We don't know who's seeing it, you know. Like I probably said to people, who's seeing you didn't know about it. You're having such an effect. So with everything that we're doing, we don't know the effect that we're having. So for me, what my end goal is to try and, change some of these guys. Not even trying to change them, just trying to like build them up or be there for them.
Mm-hmm.
Someone they can connect with and relate. Because these girls, they come from like middle class and all this. They ain't gonna you ain't going to connect with these dudes. You ain't not going to connect with these guys.
Mm-hmm.
Mate, I just want to be there with someone. Hopefully they can connect with, maybe guide them and, you know, and say things, trying to build them up, give them that help, give them that confidence, something that I never had. And that's all I want to do, man. Just try and... And there's a guy I was speaking to, he's watching the football, and he's like, I've seen you on YouTube, I've seen you're doing this. I was like, yeah. I was like, Ben, oh, my name's Mark, and we were talking. He goes, what you're doing is really good. And I started talking to him, and he's done quite a bit as well. Actually, at the youth centre I was at, he's the one who put all the boxing equipment up there. And I was like, fucking hell, it's a small world. It's funny how you meet people when you're on something. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Doors open.
Doors open. You meet people. Like, it's all connected. And he said to me, there's one lad he'll never forget. He was a very troubled lad. He was always causing trouble. And then years later, he was in Tesco's shopping. I'm like, Mark, you all right? He turns around. He goes, oh, it's such and such. And there he is, Mrs. Kid, and I go, oh, mate, yeah, I'm doing all this and do that. And even that, it gets me emotional. I just think if one day in so many years, someone come up to me, like, oh, Ben, man, you really, like, do you know what I mean? I went and done this, man, thank you. Like, man, that's it, man, I've done it. I've achieved it, man. If I can just stop someone going through that pain. Because it's bullshit. The street life is bullshit. I know it. Sometimes it can't be, for certain things happen, for certain circumstances, but... the amount of pain I had to go through, the amount of things that I've seen, the horrible things I've heard, and, you know, I was living with murderers and killers and, like, do you know what I mean, real dudes I met, I've seen it all, I've seen some disgusting people, all in my high profile, do you know what I mean, like, you can't just wash that away from you, it's stuck with me now, you know, and I accept that, and I live with that, you know, I'm trying to deal with it, hopefully I keep doing it, you know, just having all this is really... energizing me to achieve it. Hopefully the fight comes through, because that's like, you know, the climax for, I have to have this fight. But
how are you dealing with it all?
How?
Do you think since you've been out, everything's moving a bit fast for you? Are you enjoying the journey?
I'm enjoying
the wave. Make sure you're enjoying it though.
Yeah.
Don't put too much pressure on yourself. Life is for living.
Yeah.
You've made your fuck ups. You're trying to rectify it by doing good, but also sometimes we can try and save the world, but still we still need to try and save ourselves, which is very important. Mm. Your energy is powerful. You've got to create it to get you in a better mindset so people can look up to you and go, if he can do it, I can do it.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean?
You
must keep protecting yourself. Always protect yourself from everything else, because it's difficult. We try and save the world. We're doing good, so we try and give people the tools and techniques to follow us, but they ain't ready. Because if somebody told me the shit that I was talking now 5 years ago, I'd have told them to fuck off.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? You've got to be ready and understand that everything is possible. Everything.
What did it for you? You know, what, the law of attraction? What was the last of June?
I read The Power of Now, man.
The Power of Now.
I always promote that book. I read that at 30.
Mm.
I was just partying. I was fucking around. I just lost so many people to murder, suicide, overdose. I had police at the door. I've been visiting prisons for a very young age, for as young as I can remember. Just got to see family members. And yeah, man, my mum and dad did what they could. They loved me. But money was always tight. We stayed in a place called Stonyhurst Street in Glasgow. It was fucking wild. And and I went through a bit of a turmoil. Fucked it, went on the drink, drugs, went on a roller coaster, hid behind the pain, masked it with laughter, fear, just anxiety. And then I changed at 30. And then I've had a couple of speed bumps along the way. I've fucked it a few times, back on the gear. Now I'm back on the path again. I've learned. Yeah. I know now that everything that I do is my decision. I know what's right for me. I know what's wrong for me. Mm. Nobody can tell me otherwise. So if I fuck up, it's my own doing. I can't point fingers anymore. I can't keep blaming. But now I know what I'm doing.
Mm.
People, everything I've said 2 years ago, I've done. Now I'm just going to take over and keep pushing.
Mm.
And just as what it is, just keep hustling. It's a struggle.
Mm.
Life ain't fucking easy. People always tell me, you're killing it, you're doing well, you're doing this. I don't feel fuck all. I still feel the same guy 5 years, 10 years ago. More problems come as well. I've got more problems and issues that I had 10 years ago when shit was going wrong, but I handle it better. Mm. I do not shy away, I do not fucking hide. You cannot tell me I'm a coward. 35 years ago, 34, last 34 years, you could have, not now. I'm doing it. I'm not asking for approval. I'm doing it. I'm doing what I can. But sometimes I question it. What does it mean? I don't know what it fucking means. I just know that I'm not harming anybody.
Yeah.
I found a passion. I'm very good at what I do. And I'll take it further. My visions and ideas might change in 5 years. I was very good at starting something and never finishing it. Now I'm going to finish this. Now I'm going to take over. I will be the biggest on the planet, I believe, in the next 3 years. And even if, but again, I question it. What does it mean? Is that my ego? Is that my addiction?
Does it feel right? That's what
it feels right. I feel as if I can create a platform so big where people will change lives, not just one, not just two, but millions. We can we can just create that. You don't need to feel alone. You don't need to be depressed. Now people say that slogan, it's okay not to be okay. Is it okay? It's okay not to be okay. But again, it's true, but you don't need to live there. Do you know what I mean? You don't need to feel the pain and the misery every fucking day. You can make the changes. You can change your neural pathways to the way you think, to the way you feel, to the way you speak. You can change the whole dynamics of your life, but you must dig deep to do it. Because if you've done 10, 20, 30, 40 years of wrongdoing, drug abuse, whatever it is you've done, you can't just change that in one day.
No.
It's a small, steady process, but just remind yourself, when you have one bad day, then go and have two good. But again, we're doing it, mate. Sometimes I wing it. Like you say, there's no questions here. You know what I mean? I don't know what the fuck I'm doing.
I just wing it.
People say, oh, yeah. I ain't got a clue.
We're representing this, we're just winging it.
Says you're doing amazing. Sometimes I walk away and go, fooled you, you cunt. Because I don't know what the fuck I'm doing. I just know what I'm doing is working and people enjoy it.
Yeah.
That will fizzle. That will go out. But then I'll just, I don't want to be one of these guys sitting in a pub and saying I could have been a contender. I could have made it at 40 years of age, 50. These people know where their fuck ups went.
Yeah.
So why not doing something now that you've still got air in your lungs to now create something now that you know fucked up your life 20 years ago? I don't want to be one of those guys. So now I'll just create 30 in my 30s and show the world that what I can do from just believing. And yourself, fuck everybody else. That's and it is scary PTIW, because...
Prove them all wrong.
Fuck them all, mate.
That's
but
it. I'm doing it. We're doing it. And it, you know,
how did your book come about? The Law of Attraction?
You know when you like... You find a girlfriend, you find a girl, it's like, whoa, she want to show her off. Like, they call it trophy girls. You find like a trophy girl and everyone wants to show her off.
Mm-hmm.
I found Law of Attraction. It was my trove. I wanted to tell the world. I wanted to show Law of Attraction off to the world. And all these books, like Tony Robbins once put, like, he put a quote saying, like, because technically my book in the library would be self-help. Do you know what I mean? That's the category. Yeah. It's not the categories. It might be under self-help. And Tony Robbins was saying, when it comes to, like, self-help books, a lot of people don't read past the second chapter. So that stuck with me because I started doing research. I wanted to write a book. And then so I went and got these self-help books and I counted how many sort of pages two chapters was, averagely about, like, 40. So I thought, if I write a book less than 40 pages... they're going to read it all, aren't they? It's two chapters, isn't it? So they're not just going to read two chapters of my book and fuck it off and get bored. They're going to read the whole thing. So I thought, all right, so I've got to break it down to 40. I've got to break it down. I wanted it. Sometimes I read books, there's words and shit I don't understand. Like, I come from a council estate, you know, my, I can't spell. I can read, but I can't spell and things. And a lot of people I know are like that, or they can't sit in for long periods and read, or, you know. Especially now when you've got so much social medias and so many distraction TVs, you know, a lot of people sit like now and read books. People do, people don't. All this audio or whatever. So, I just wanted to put the science behind Law of Attraction. A lot of people, like, say Law of Attraction, when they don't know about it and I talk to them about it, I think, what's that? Is that a religion? I was like, no, it's not really a religion. You could call it, that's how I'm having faith, but there's a lot of science behind Law of Attraction. Is a vibe. What is a vibe? A vibe is a vibration at a frequency, and there's so much when I start going on a journey, learning about it, you know, sitting around how to raise your vibrations, and, you know, we look at things and we think, you know, that's solid. That's not solid, bro. That's just vibrating at a different frequency. Mm-hmm. We're made up of the same thing, which is an atom. You know, everything. Oh, I've got the same atoms as the sea, the grass, everything. So my whole journey of learning about it, again, I just wanted to try and put it into words that other people can understand, and they could sort of see, like, how I've fallen in love with something. Read this, it'll make you feel like, I try and, you know, was it, you can take the horse to water, but I wanted, like, to take the water to everyone and be like, look, this is the book, and, you know, read, and, you know, let me know what you think.
Everything is frequencies. I know some people struggle with that, but if you look at the Wi-Fi connection as well, you can't see it, but it can connect you with people from all around the world. The same as any vibration. If you think about a friend or sometimes they'll phone you straight away and you go, fuck me, I'm just thinking about you. It's just, everything is connected. Even ex-partners or whatever, there's a connection there. Same as if you sleep with a girl, it's a sexual energy exchange, yeah. It's called, where it's like plugging your fucking phone into charge. You're taking on the pain, the trauma, whatever they're dealing with, as well as the people who's also been with them. So, again, mate, I was a womanizer, so my head, one of the reasons my head was fucked, because you're fucking all these different energies and fucking while on top of drugs and drink and gambling. Your head's fucked, and yet you think you're okay. Mm. You think you have a sleep and the slate's wiped clean, but it's not. Mm. You've got to really cleanse yourself and become a better person. And then once your vibration starts happening, I wouldn't be sitting here if I was doing the stuff that I was doing. No, so it clearly works if you... It's everybody's mad, got an aura, yeah. So if you do bad stuff, it will poke holes in your aura, and that's right. When all the negative stuff comes in. Look, people walk into a room, I know energies, you know who's sad, you know who's feeling depressed. I can pick a sentence up and pick somebody's spirits up straight away, because I just know straight away who's approachable, who's not. I don't know why I've got it. I did a Reiki course, which I always speak about, but that's all about healing energies, and it might sound crazy, but it works for me. It could be crazy. But again,
it works, isn't it?
You know what I mean? You're not hurting anybody.
I'm at the
whole
universe, bro. I was in Broadmoor. I was in Ashford. Months ago, minute I was
fucking good
talking
gear,
with
that,
the universe, bro. Yeah. Like, I'm at the whole universe. Yeah.
So when you get out, then when did you get your lib date?
17th of July. Just gone.
Did you know it was coming up, or did you?
I knew I had my parole coming up. Mm-hmm. I knew they was being serious about releasing me because they found me accommodation.
How many times did you go to the parole board?
That was my third. I lost the other two. I lost the two before.
Did you ever feel like quitting and thinking, fuck it, this isn't working?
Of course. You know, it's them tests, but, you know, it's the support that I think, you know, a lot of self-talk, and it is like you said, you have to dig deep. You know, you got to really sort of dig deep. What am I going to do? Like, just give up and that's it. I mean, the vision of this dream I've got, I have to do it. And I just, you know, there was course of times that, you know, I fell down and still, I thought, I can't do this, man. I want to do this. And even since coming out now, I'm like, oh shit, you know, with the boxing, I'm getting schooled left, right and centre with the boxing and that. You know, I'm coming on every week. There's one pro I'm training with. When we first sparred, he black-eyed me a couple months ago. He black-eyed me in the gym. Mm-hmm. I thought, you know, But then we sparred 2 weeks ago. He's like, you come on a million times. Do you know what I mean? Again, having my cousin's support. It's just about having that. I had to go back and read my own book at sometimes, like actually read my own book
yourself.
To remind, and then it's about right, like trying to remember how Lord Chat, like, you know, remembering how certain things have come in life because you've manifested it. And I said, I've got, you know, just got to keep sometimes them happen because, you know, what we're manifesting, certain scenarios have to happen for you to go on that path. Like how I met, you know, Liam Galvin, who I'm doing the filming with, you know, I met him through me escaping. You know, I wouldn't have met him if I didn't escape from I escaped at one point in the hospital. And I wouldn't have met him if I didn't escape. Now, this whole journey with Liam is, you know, Liam's been fantastic. You know, he's like, honestly, he's been like my adopted dad now, man. He is. And, you know, he's the one putting through Joe and Dave and everything. He really saw my vision. I was in a mental hospital, bro. James, be real. If I rang you up, yeah? If I rang you up from a mental hospital, bro, a couple of years back, I said, mate, listen, how I got Liam's number, I can't even remember. But I got this geezer's personal number and I thought, I've probably got about a minute on the phone with him before he thinks, what the fuck, and like hangs up on me. So I've got about a minute. So I sat there for a while. I thought, oh, I could try and, you know, try and play it cool and I say this. And I rang the phone. I was like, listen, man, I'm the only geezer kid out of the pool, man. I've got this girl, I want to be a fighter. And I was like, rambled for a minute, yeah, and it just went quiet. And I thought, is he still there? And I think it was like, what was it? Oh, fuck off, Harry, or something like that. He thought I was one of his mates ringing him up, winding him up. And I was like, no, it's not a wind up. Honestly, can you just hear me out, what I've got to say? And he, you know, he's like, okay, we'll talk next week. And, you know, and I sat there the whole week, please ring, please. But then I sort of felt, I knew you would. I just, everything you've done with the films, and I knew my story. I knew I've had papers ringing me up. I knew I had a story, and I knew I had something. I felt it. And he did, he ran back up, and, you know, and he started hearing me out more. And then, you know, when I was on day releases, when we'd done some training, we did some filming, did some interviews, he stuck with me for the whole process, man.
Yeah, fair play.
Yeah, and it's been amazing. He saw it, and, you know, again, like, sitting here, man, it's crazy. Like,
but it's good when we get somebody who fights your corner, who doesn't walk away, who doesn't run away.
Yeah.
Because if you've got abandonment issues and you've seen it your whole life that everybody turns against you, it's hard to trust anyone.
Yeah.
It's hard to give your full trust to someone to go, okay, you believe in me, I'm not going to let you down. Look at Mike Tyson as well, his trainer, and when he died, he kind of went off the rails as well. So we need to come to a conclusion and come to understand that obstacles will arise.
Yeah.
People do come and go in your life. It's not to be that if they walk away, then so be it. People will come into your life, you'll learn a lesson, then they'll go away. Everybody comes into your life for a lesson, I believe. That's what I've truly understood now, and that's what I'm still working on. That no matter who comes into your life, there's always lessons, no matter what it is. So when you get out then, what was it like for the very first day you get out?
I had a party. There was a party.
Seen the video?
Have you seen the video? Have you seen the video?
Yeah, I watched it today on the train.
Yeah, that was a video. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was
your friend done that?
Yeah, it was a friend. Mm-hmm. They done that at a party people grew up with, and my cousins and that. It was crazy. So yeah, I had a party, man, and my friend done the singing. Did you see my friend with the singing?
Yeah.
He's sick, isn't he? Mm-hmm. He could be something. Mm-hmm. He's like, there was music and all that, and it was just such a good vibe. It was weird because I just felt like, oh, I've got to be back. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It felt still quite...
Where did you stay? Did you have somewhere to stay when you came out?
Yeah, accommodation. I got a flat
secure unit
in Hastings. No, it's a flat. Yeah. I'm in a flat now in Hastings. So, to go back, obviously my conditions, I had to be there at night. So I had the party, went back that night. And it's just sort of weird waking up in the morning. Like, this time's breakfast, going down to the... Oh, no one's there. I've got to do it myself now. I walked down to Asda's, a little walk, and I walked down there and got some bits of shopping. I got some most random shit as well. It didn't even make sense what things I got. Yeah. I come back, I was like, this doesn't even go, right? And it was just, yeah. And it's
what
just,
time are you getting up in the morning? You're still up at 6, 7?
Yeah, 7:30 every morning. Yeah. 7:30 I'm up. 7:30.
But that's a good thing as well.
Yeah.
What's your daily routine like now?
Again, still adjusting. With everything that's going on, it's still sort of... I've got my trainings. Okay, I've got some, amazing coaches. Jamie McGuigan, again, a young guy who's been my coach, who's really, he's seen what he's doing. And a guy, Zach, who's my strength and conditioning coach. Mm-hmm. He's not even doing it for money, but he sees what I'm doing. He's training me, taking time out of twice a week, and he's not charging.
How does that make you feel? People are giving you an opportunity. They can see that there's something there. They believe in you. How does that make you feel?
Amazing, man. No one believes in me. Do you know what I mean? I never felt equal in the system. So you've gone from not even... Sometimes I don't even feel like worthy. Sometimes I don't even feel equal. Do you know what I mean? Because I'm so used to sort of being like down here when everyone's there, like in the system. And like now, you're having them normal conversations. It's and then people believing in what I'm doing. I think a lot of people are relating to, people have either fucked up in life or people, trying to help. Like a lot of... I'm connecting with a lot of people. And people see what I'm doing and they're giving me time and energy and it's giving me more motivation to achieve this. You know what I'm saying, James?
Yeah.
And it's sort of like, and it's been an amazing experience what's going on at the minute. And what's it all for? We don't know. I don't know what it's all for, but I'm doing it. I'm winging it. And it feels right, so it must be right. Who knows where it's going?
Yeah.
But it's working, and I'm getting people like Situ Coconut. They're saying, people that I look up to people. I'm like, wow, I'm a fan of, Dragan Day, I'm like fans of, and they're telling me what you're doing is good, and I've got to be doing fucking something right. I mean, sitting here with you, James. Come on, man. Do you know what I mean? This is you giving me an opportunity to come here.
Mm-hmm.
It's enough respect. It's enough love for giving me the opportunity to come here, talk with you,
Yeah, I spoke to you on the phone, man. You reached out, so why not?
Yeah.
Everything's about giving people chances, and this isn't a chance. You're doing me a favour just as much as I'm doing you one. It's teamwork. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? You're getting your story out there. People are going to watch it. It's still, people will pick things up from it. I've seen your story. I said, man, this boy's got something. You've just got to keep grinding, man. Keep pushing, and the world's yours, mate. Just go out and fucking take it, brother.
Yeah.
So going forward then for the future, tell me what's Ben going to do? What's he going to achieve?
Well, no, he needs someone to get the license for the fight. Fucking COVID's it's completely, even that is testing my vision a bit. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Even COVID's really knocking it.
You push through it though.
Exactly, that's just obstacles.
They're
saying only top athlete can fight at the minute. They're saying top elite fighters, that's it. They're saying, we was trying to get a license in Essex to set the venue. Yeah, Alan, who I'm meant to be fighting for the IBA, but this, Essex refused the license, and all because of COVID. It's like, so I'm training, I've got people, and it's like, I'm meant to be fighting. Like, when am I getting this? When can I fight?
Yeah, but it will pass. Mm. These are just tests, so be patient. You've been patient your whole fucking life anyway, especially if you're in Broadmoor. You need to be patient, do you know what I mean? In the fucking loony bin.
There's no such thing as time in fucking Broadmoor, bro. There's no such thing as time.
He's all dressed. What's the the dress code light in there?
Well, they just can't. Yeah, a lot of them still sort of, they'll keep the old sort of, right, fashion sort of.
Is that?
Yeah, it's like, they say like normal clothes, but it's not, mm-hmm. you know, especially the old school ones, like, it's called the arseholes, they used to like wearing that, and the POF badge, like Prison Officers mm-hmm. Association, and you just feel, oh, fucking arsehole. You know, yeah. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but the COVID will pass, bro. Mm. This is just test. It will happen sooner. Yeah. And later, so I wouldn't. It's just being impatient because you've waited all this time to get your chance to prove that you're doing something, but you're already doing it. Yeah. Sitting here, you're doing it. Training in the gym, you're doing it.
Yeah.
These are the goals, these are the steps. It's just a case of chipping away, man. So, where do you see yourself in the boxing? Do you see yourself future world champion, or do you just see yourself just being happy to fight and showing people
just being happy
change?
To fight? But when I get in that ring, I ain't gonna dance around. I'm not gonna, you know, I'm coming to war. Do you know what I mean? Like when I step into that ring, I'm gonna bring something. Do you know what I mean? When people wanna see that, when they wanna see an entertaining fight, that's what I'm gonna bring to the table. I'm gonna bring that energy. I'm gonna bring that exuberance. Even when I walk out, people will think it's gonna be a fight. And I promise, when I get in that ring with whoever, it's gonna be fireworks. And I promise that. And that's what I wanna offer. I wanna give people excitement and say, look, you know, from fucking life sentence in Broadmoor to like watching this guy who's putting on one of the best fucking fights you've seen. That's it, achieved.
Yeah, fair play. You know what I mean? Do you enjoy getting punched?
I take it.
Some people do. It's been through a lot of pain, a lot of prison time. They enjoy it because it's a bit of just showing them that they're alive, but they also embrace it because they've been through that much pain.
Exactly.
They enjoy fighting.
No, I won't stop. I will not stop. When I get in that ring, when this all happens now, I will not stop. Like, I'm coming, do you know what I mean? I'm coming to fight. You know, I'm not going to be one of these half-hearted guys, James. It's not going to be me. Like, I'm coming. So whoever out there, we've got any more promoters out there, and they want a fighter. They want someone who's going to give their heart. You know, I will bring. That's me. Do you get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The energy I've got for this. It's everything. You know, this fight. And I'm trying to put everything into it. I've got the trainers in and, you know, we can't even spar now, bro. We have to spar. Not like we have a secret space that we have to. We've matted out and that. That I have to bring people into spar. You can't even do pad works in there. So like trying to, like, you know, again, I'm you know, I can fight, but boxing's a different thing. So me trying to learn all this and bring people in. Sometimes people are cautious. Oh, you're not meant to be doing that, and it's very difficult. Like, it's like the whole thing's a test right now. But it, you know, and then we get knocked back from Essex, and they say, no, we can't give you a license. But it won't stop. It won't stop me. Do you know what I mean? I will, in the end, you know, they say we can't stream because you're not allowed. I will pull it out there on my fucking Instagram or YouTube, and I'll just let everyone watch it. I'll just take a fight in some local gym to do it. Do you get what I'm saying? Because that's how it feels. You know,
yeah, but don't be impatient. It's all going to happen. You've worked that hard to get to where you are today, to keep pushing, keep hustling, finish your year strong, finish your head above water, because people are sinking, and they're sinking fast. So you must just pop your head up and say, you know what, it will pass. Fuck's sake, if you can do a stunt in Broadmoor, mate, I'm sure you can wait another 3 months to COVID passes. Do you know what I mean?
It's difficult, mate. You waited this whole time to show people
that I'm going to do it. It's in place. Where was the fight going to be?
We're two locations.
Yeah, I'm coming.
Yeah?
Yeah, fucking right, bro. I'll be there, brother. So how do you think back now, looking back in your life? What do you think from the person that you are to the man you're becoming now? How do you see it? Is it a roller coaster? Do you think sometimes, fuck, mate, did I actually live that?
Mate, massively. Listen, there was many times when I was where I could have finished it. Do you know what I mean? I thought about it. You know, not just, I think a lot of people do when they're as well, and people, you know, unfortunately do, and I've seen it.
Suicide?
And I felt it. I remember I had like really bad acne on my face when I was away, and there's a medication called Roaccutane. Don't know if you've heard it. It kills acne off. Like, they give all these mad creams and all that, but some of them work, some of them don't. But mine got bad, and they gave me Roaccutane. There's been programs about Roaccutane, and it's like, people commit suicide with this drug. It works. It got real acne, but it fucks people up and gets them depressed. I sat there on the cell one time and just sort of like scared and really upset, and I was really contemplating it. I was really contemplating suicide. Like, really. Not just, you know, when you sit and think, but I was really thinking about it. Like, you know what? I'm done. Like, I'm really done with this shit. But
yeah.
I had nothing. I had no people wanted to fucking hurt me. and I didn't feel any love, I didn't feel anything. I had no goals, I had no ambition, I had nothing. I'm just existing in a fucking in hell, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, bro, I'm just existing. But
you're here now, brother.
I'm here now. Fucking I'm coming out here now, yeah, with Jane's, yeah, English. Yeah. You know what I mean?
For anybody that's in the struggle, for anybody, yeah, that maybe feeling lonely, feeling weak, maybe suicidal, yeah, feeling neglected, what advice would you give for them?
I've been there, like, so I feel, don't just think, I'm not saying, oh, yeah, I know, I feel how you feel. Like, if you're contemplating, you're feeling it, I feel it, I was there. Yeah? You have to dig deep, just show character, just talk to people. You know, I didn't have anyone, or I didn't feel like I had anyone to speak to, but you have to sort of self-talk yourself, distract yourself, or reach out to people. If you're outside, then reach out to people that will support, even Samaritans or something. And just like you said earlier, James, just take them small steps. You know, things may be like shit right now at that time. They may feel that it's done. But look, if anyone's watching this and they're like that now, look where I am now to when how I was feeling that. Do you get what I'm saying? That from life sentence Broadmoor to meeting some amazing people, having amazing, you know, Joe, Coke, and the inspiration I'm trying to do with the whole fight, to sitting here with you. Look at that. Look at that. Do you get what I mean? Life sentence Broadmoor, done. Sitting here, interview, James English. The journey again along the way. You know what I mean? It's ups and downs. It's not easy. You know, and like you're saying, life will test us. You have to show that character. You have to find something. You have to distract and push forward.
Love it, brother. Ben, absolute pleasure, brother. Look forward to seeing your future.
Yeah.
Get your fight. I'll be there if it kicks off. And for a loud there, I'll definitely be there. Team Liam, thank you, brother.
Yeah.
Also, for people watching, how can they get you on social media? How can they watch your stuff? How can they get your book?
Yeah, in a minute, obviously, there's going to be things on YouTube, which obviously
an interview.
But if you actually want to hit me directly, it's Instagram, Ben_Hatchett official. It's like Ben Hatchett, I'll come up.
In the description anyway for people watching. Just click the links. What about your YouTube channel?
Watch the journey, Lee. Please come and support what I'm trying to do. Mm. Let's reach out. You know, come and see Law of Attraction for yourself. You know what I mean? If you're questioning it, if you're ever not sure about it, you know what I mean? Follow, you know.
Yeah, can people buy your book?
Yeah, the book's available on Amazon.
What about your YouTube channel?
No, I don't do. I don't really do the YouTube and that. Maybe I should, but
get all that everything up and running. Get your videos out there, man. Everything's business.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Everything's about building a platform. So if you can eventually tell your story or do other things, it's just reaching a wider audience. So
yeah,
it's something definitely to dig into. If you don't want to do it, then so be it. But as many platforms as you can to just keep creating awareness.
Yeah.
You're an inspiration, brother. I genuinely rooting for you. I can't wait to see what you do for the future. Again,
man, thank you.
Thank you, brother. God bless.
Check out more of my podcasts on the right, and be sure to like, share, and comment your thoughts on this week's podcast. Thank you.